After the world's energy resources were completely depleted, the corporation that controlled the world created a parallel universe to extract resources from. But something went wrong, and Earth is now on the brink of destruction. That's why going back is the only solution. A young boy is playing with a toy airplane, feeling upset about moving to a new city, where his uncle, Will Porter, has been invited to work. Meanwhile, a countdown is taking place, and a distant tower lights up brightly after launch. Porter is surprised to realize that it is working. The story shifts to a world where some kind of accident has occurred. Alarm signals sound, emergency lighting flickers, and Porter tries to figure out what has happened. He retrieves a cubic object and tries to escape the ruined building. His interface does not respond, so he's not sure if he's in the parallel universe called Echo that he was trying to reach. The laboratory has been seriously damaged, with casualties visible under the debris. Finally, Porter manages to get outside. But the city looks frightening, with wrecked cars and bodies of the dead everywhere. He sees the tower in the distance where he needs to go and contacts his colleague, Abigail Voss, who is surprised that he's alive. She informs him about an attack on the laboratory and the destruction of the cube and sends him her coordinates. Several years ago, the corporation Alterplex developed a tower capable of converting the mass of parallel universes into quantum energy that will power the Earth for the next millennium. Former NASA astronaut Will Porter is invited to participate in the testing. The head of the corporation security, Abigail Voss, is impressed with Porter's abilities. He is a physicist who can fly. But the interview does not interest the man, as he has personal obligations. Abigail admits that she is aware of his help to her sister and nephew and considers it noble. However, his family will be fully provided for, and Porter himself will have the opportunity to explore the limits of the impossible. The woman hands Porter a folder with secret documents, and he opens it. Present time, Porter, holding his nephew's airplane, walks through the deserted city and tries to call his sister, but her phone is unreachable. The explorer realizes that he's on a parallel Earth, Echo, and his jump was successful. The man heads towards the tower, unaware of what the hell is happening around him. The destruction and bodies of the dead indicate that there was a suppression of the city's residents' uprising. But why? He tries to find information and learns that the rebels initially fired at employees of the Alterplex Corporation, but then began targeting ordinary citizens as well. The leader of the rebels made a statement against the corporation's tower, which according to him poses a threat to the entire planet. After the tower was turned on a week ago, the entire system became unstable. Meanwhile, Alterplex launched its own security drones and announced the expansion of the evacuation zone around the tower. After hearing these messages, Porter watches flocks of restless birds and an unnaturally glowing sky, believing he has witnessed a gravitational anomaly. The man is walking down the street and sees a boat in the middle of it. At that moment, there is an explosion and Porter is wounded in the hand. He finds a nearby pharmacy and treats the wound, while also noticing that his cube is almost fully charged. As he exits the pharmacy, he witnesses a drone attacking a car with people in it, which is subsequently destroyed. The aggressors notice him and Porter has to run away from them. One of the rebels catches up with him, but then lowers his gun as he recognizes Porter. The man is his former comrade, Michael, and he is very surprised that Porter is alive since he saw him die. At that moment, an alarm sounds, and a combat drone appears from a pipe. Michael shows his cube, and the drone warns Porter that he is listed as deceased and orders him to stay in place. Suddenly, an anomaly activates in the sky, and a burning train falls from the clouds. Michael snaps his colleague out of his daze and urges him to run away from the area. Porter remembers how Abigail first brought him to the laboratory, where he heard a lecture about a corporation that found a way out of the energy crisis by relying on the discoveries of two scientists. By transforming space and time, the tower can create a parallel universe, but with one difference, there will be no organics, only space offering an unlimited amount of energy. The tower will create numerous gravitational portals through which energy will flow to Earth 1. But for this to happen, Porter must penetrate the second parallel Earth and install the cube on the tower in a special terminal. In the present, he expresses his confusion to Michael. Nobody was supposed to be copied. The world was supposed to be empty, and he shows Michael the cube. Apparently, the system is resisting and attracting objects from the real world. At that moment, a car drives onto the street, and Abigail gets out and accuses Michael of destroying the lab, but he urges him not to trust the woman. She calls Porter to come with her because their leader, Reynard, is gathering the remnants of the team. They need to fix everything, but then the drone appears again and opens fire on them. They get into an empty car and drive away, shooting back at the pursuer. They manage to shoot down the drone. The action is transported to the past, when news of the disappearance of a large number of vehicles began airing on all TV channels after the tower was launched. In the present, the people come to an overturned car after the explosion, and Abigail again talks about Reynard, although it was his drone that almost killed them. But Porter intends to get to the tower and fix everything. The woman reports that the attackers destroyed the cube, and now everything is useless, not suspecting that Porter has a copy of the cube. Nevertheless, she agrees to go to the tower. On the way, Porter tries to call his sister again, and Abigail says that his family has been evacuated. They run through the city, hiding from the drones, and see working televisions showing reports of ocean liners falling from the sky. And when they come out into one of the covered galleries, they find a multitude of bodies arranged in a certain order along the edges of the street. They are shocked by this, and Michael says that it is the work of the corporation security personnel. He saw them doing it himself, so he left there. Another drone appears, and they hide in the cabin of a crashed plane. But they are found by armed men, and the shootout begins with explosions ringing out. The trio rushes out onto the street and fires at the cars. Porter remembers the day the tower started operating and how he was thrilled by the prospects it opened up for humanity. But it was also the day the first warnings came from the rebel group predicting disaster. Porter's consciousness flickers from the wound he sustained, and he sees the leader of the rebels, who is unhappy that he was brought to their center. However, he still allows them to help him. The rebel group's medical equipment performs surgery on his leg, while Michael tries to encourage his friend, and Porter's consciousness fades again. He regains consciousness from a push by the rebel leader, who is very angry at everyone who works for the corporation. They find a box in Porter's belongings, and he asks to be released so that he can go to the tower. Abigail is shocked but does not reveal what it is. The leader pulls out a gun, but then there is an explosion, and Reynard's people burst into the room. Porter, Michael, and Abigail run again, despite the warning. They hide in the underground galleries, and the woman confesses that the cube is a nullifier. If the balance cannot be established, the cube will completely shut down this universe. They will have to destroy one universe so that the other can survive. The action shifts to the past, when Porter learns that his family is unhappy in their new location. In the present, he heads to his home despite Abigail's pleas, and on the way he sees a horrifying sight. A ship defying all laws of nature rising into the sky. Later, he finds his burning house and the bodies of his loved ones. He remembers how he decides to quit his job at the tower. But at that moment, security personnel from the corporation arrive and take him to the laboratory. The same thing happens in the present. The same people find him in the wreckage of his house, take the cube, beat him up, and take him on Reynard's helicopter, who talks about their interweaving of worlds, and offers Porter to make the jump again to save at least one world. Pretending to agree, Porter, remembering his pilot skills, carries out a diversion and directs the helicopter down. He comes to his senses on the ground, finds the cube, and then the security personnel appear again. Their commander is ready to kill Michael, but armed, Porter does not let him. The men leave the crash site in a military car because they need to activate that damn backup switch. But Michael dies at the tower itself, and Porter goes into the tower alone. He finds the necessary console and prepares to insert the cube, but then Abigail appears and shoots Porter, who is confident that this world is already dying, which the woman disagrees with. Nevertheless, he manages to activate the cube, and Abigail shoots him again. He sees everything around him collapsing, and in the next moment, he finds himself in his own home and sees his loved ones. And this is where the movie ends.